Hey guys, how's it going? I'm Sydney from PhoneDoc.com, and I'm back with the Impulse 4G from AT&T. This is one of their budget Android smartphones. It's only $30 on contract, but the nice thing is that it's a 4G device that uses AT&T's HSPA Plus network. So I've been testing it out. I'm gonna give you guys a full review. Before we get onto that, I have to say a special thanks to our friends at Best Buy Mobile. We thank them all the time because they send us free phones that we can add to our One Paw Bandit game, which is the game where you guys can win free phones. One of the great things about Best Buy Mobile is that when you go there, you don't have to worry about rebates. You don't have to wait for it. You don't have to worry about sending it in or remembering it or forgetting about it. The price on the tag is the price you pay. So thank you, Best Buy Mobile, for being so awesome. Thank you guys for watching this video. It's the Impulse 4G review from AT&T. I'm Sydney from PhoneDoc.com. Let's go check it out. Okay, so here we go with the Impulse 4G from AT&T. It is a budget-friendly Android smartphone. It's only $30 on contract. That being said, just because you pay a low price for a phone doesn't mean that you should have to sacrifice too much. You know, you still want a phone that's usable, that performs well enough for you to use on a daily basis. So that's what, you know, that's the question that comes up whenever you're thinking about the Impulse. Okay, it's budget friendly, but some low-end Android smartphones, they don't really deliver in terms of performance. So to start off, we'll do a quick hardware tour of the Impulse. On the front here, we have a 3.8-inch display, which is actually nice. You know, a lot of mid-range or low-end devices or Android devices, they tend to have a 3.2-inch display or a 3.5-inch display, which is just a little bit too small for some people. You know, my hands are pretty tiny, which makes every phone look huge. But even for my little hand, sometimes a 3.2-inch display is just a little too small. So it's nice that the Impulse has a 3.8-inch display, just a little bit bigger. It's gonna make typing a little bit easier with a larger display. I'll talk more about the keyboard later. It has a resolution of 800 by 480. So again, a mid-range resolution, definitely better than some of the cheapo Android devices that are on the market, but still pictures and text, it's gonna be a little pixelated. So you can see when we get close here, the letters are a little bit blocky. Whenever you're looking at graphics, it is gonna be a little grainy depending on how far you zoom in. So it's a decent resolution, but still, not anything that's gonna impress you or blow you away. The capacitive touchscreen works really well. You can see it's smooth. The physical screen itself isn't too sticky, so I can easily scroll through and it's very responsive. Right underneath the display, you have the four Android buttons for back, menu, home, and search. You can see they are capacitive touch buttons, not physical buttons that you have to press. On the right side, there is no dedicated camera button, and this is purely subjective. Some people like having it, some people don't. For some people, it doesn't bother you at all. Me personally, I like having the dedicated camera button, but it's not a big deal, so that's just something to take note of. There is no camera key. On the top is the power button, which is also the screen lock button. And then you also have the 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, volume rocker buttons on the left side, and then on the bottom is the microphone and the micro USB port. On the back is the camera, and we'll talk more about the camera later on. But I do want to talk about just the overall experience of the device. It is an Android smartphone, but it doesn't ship with a custom user interface over Android. So Huawei hasn't added any changes to stock Android. So you're going to get everything that you would get with a stock build of Android 2.2. So you can see the dock at the bottom, just very plain and simple. Then you can go to the app drawer and it scrolls in that 3D box sort of way. When we go to messaging, there's no customizations here. Again, it's stock Android. You do have the option in terms of a keyboard. You have the standard Android keyboard, or you can use swipe. So swipe is, some people prefer that. I usually just like using a normal keyboard. So I mentioned earlier that having this larger display makes typing a little bit easier, because sometimes on the smaller screens your thumbs get a little bit cramped, but it is big enough for a comfortable typing experience. And of course you can use it in landscape mode, and then it's even larger. So we'll type out "the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog."
And of course, I just typed that really quickly. I'm not paying attention to errors. You can see I had a couple there. That's all going to be on, you know, the size of your thumbs or how comfortable you are with the keyboard. But I will say that having that 3.8 inch display definitely helps and makes the typing experience much better than other low-end devices with a smaller display. And then you have the notification bar with no real changes there. Out of the box, you do get your standard Android widgets. You can see a couple of these are ones that I've added. That's a game. You have the analog clock, calendar, Facebook, Google search, home screen tips, the market, MyFM. That's not a widget that comes with every Android device, but it is, as you know, as the name suggests, it's just an FM radio widget. So if I were to open that, there's no room on that screen. So we'll go to another screen. Go to MyFM, and you can see that's what it looks like. It's just a radio, basically. But again, it doesn't come with every Android device, so if you like that feature, it's kind of unique to the Impulse. And then you have news and weather, picture frame, traffic. Slacker, again, is one that I've downloaded. Twitter, that does come with the phone out of the box. Wi-Fi hotspot, as well as YouTube. So the phone can act as a Wi-Fi hotspot for up to 5 devices, and you can see it has a widget, so it's very easy to turn it off and on. You simply tap it to turn it on, and then it kind of, you know, takes a while for it to pick up, and then you can easily access the settings for the Wi-Fi hotspot with that widget. So it's nice to have the widget, and of course it's nice to have that feature. You know, of course you're gonna have to keep an eye on the data, because that's where it can kind of get you into trouble. Now, as I said, this does ship with Android 2.2 out of the box. I don't have any official word on if or when it will get Android 2.3 Gingerbread. AT&T has said that all of their devices that came out in 2011 will get 2.3. We just don't know when, so it remains to be seen if they'll keep to that promise, but at least that's what we've heard for now. I'll turn off Wi-Fi hotspot. So let's move on and talk about, you know, one of the great things about this phone is that it's a 4G device, which is something that you really don't see on budget smartphones. That's usually saved for the phones in the more, you know, $200 to $300 price range. But it is a 4G phone. Now, it uses AT&T's HSPA Plus network, which technically isn't true 4G, and, you know, even compared to other networks that aren't true 4G either, it's even slower than those. That being said, it is still a 4G device, so I'm not going to knock it at all. I'll show you guys the results that I've gotten with the speed test app. I live in the Dallas area, and I've tested the phone out in several different parts of the Dallas area. So where I'm at right now, you can see I don't have full bars. It kind of fluctuates between 1 and 3, but I've tested it out in other areas where I do have a very good connection. But you can see the average download speed is about 1.3. You know, if you were to add this together, you know, it ranges between 1.2 and 1.6. But, you know, generally the average is 1.3. The upload speeds have actually been pretty good. There's been maybe one or two times where the upload speeds are actually faster than the download speed, which is kind of surprising. Granted, the upload speeds don't usually matter to a whole lot of people, but they've been pretty decent as well. Now, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, that's not very good for 4G, but it is pretty good. You know, it's okay for AT&T's network. Their advertised peak speeds are 14.4 megabits per second, but I'm just gonna tell you that you're never gonna get those speeds. Those are, like, you know, in pristine, excellent conditions, and you're just never gonna get 14.4. So, you know, 1.3, it's not excellent, but it's still decent, better than probably what you would, or hopefully it's better than what you would get with a 3G phone on AT&T's network. And you can see I do have an HSPA Plus connection right now. Of course, the phone supports Wi-Fi, so anytime you're around a Wi-Fi hotspot, you can easily connect to that. Let's go to the browser, and I don't know if you guys saw this article, but apparently someone thinks that Nicolas Cage is a vampire. But we'll take a look at the web browser, since we're talking about wireless and data speeds. And I am connected to Wi-Fi right now, so this won't, you know, you won't be able to see what 4G speeds are like, mostly just because, like I said, where I'm at right now, I don't have a great connection, so I am using Wi-Fi. So we'll wait for this to load. Now, I'll also talk about here I'll start talking about the processor and the way it performs. So we'll, you know, get a chance to see pinch to zoom. Later on, I'll move on to, you know, quadrant standard results and things like that. Okay, so the page has loaded. And you can see scrolling is actually pretty smooth. Now this phone has an 800 megahertz processor, which is fairly mid-range. You know, it seems like, you know, the 1 gigahertz processor, which used to be, you know, high-end super phones, and now it kind of seems like a lot of mid-range devices are getting 1 gigahertz processors. So, you know, 800 megahertz, I would still consider that mid-range, but again, you know, it depends on how you look at it, but still a pretty decent processor. It's a Qualcomm processor. So you can see scrolling is pretty smooth, and then I'm gonna do pinch to zoom, and that is actually very responsive for being a mid-range device, for having that 800 megahertz processor, and you can see we have the flash plugins loaded right now. So for it to be this smooth and this responsive, that is very impressive. Now, if you watch my unboxing video, you know that there were a couple times when there were a few hiccups, so it's not always this smooth. It is choppy sometimes, but still, on, you know, this is basically what you're gonna get, you know, what I've experienced on a consistent basis, and that is just extremely smooth for a device of this caliber. You're probably not gonna get that on a whole lot of other devices that are in this price range. So definitely very impressive. You know, again, with flash content loaded, and phonedog.com is a pretty heavy web page, so I'm very impressed with the performance in that. Again, while we're in the web browser here, this is the stock Android web browser, so you do have the option of loading up multiple windows. So I can go to, I can go to google.com, load up that, and then go back to the web page I was at before. So that's just a quick look at the stock Android web browser. What you're gonna get out of the box, of course you can download other web browsers from the Android market that other people say are better, but this is the experience that you're gonna get out of the box, and it is pretty good.